Hello friends, myself Sampath Kumar. In this video, we are going to talk about departmental accounts. So what we will do is, first we will talk something about the theory part. And we'll also be solving some numerical problems. The practical problems or numerical problems or illustrations. Our focus is to first understand the theory, like what are the types of departments that we have. What are the methods through which you can prepare the departmental accounts? That is the theory part. Or on what basis you will allocate the common expenditure. So these things we need to understand from theory perspective. Once we are done with this theory perspective, we can start solving the problems. Okay. The problem is that most of the times what we do is we directly hit this problem areas. We will get, but sometimes what happens is we don't understand what is the concept behind that. Okay, so it's always important to have the background check, that is through theory part and then the practical sums. Okay, so with that understanding, let's get started. So I am referring ICAI CA intermaterial, and the same is also available in the description, which is again, it's a public document, everybody can watch it. So what we will do is just open your study material if you happen to be a CA student. Because why am I referring CA institute material is only that there shouldn't be any other material other than this. So whatever is given in the institute material is sufficient. They will be asking the questions from the institute material only, be it study material or practice manual, RTP or MTP or mock test papers or somewhere or other, or past examination questions with some modifications. They'll be asking the questions from the institute material only. So if you happen to be a CMS students, I would suggest you go through all your study material, practice manual or whatever you call it. You first go through your all material given by the respective institutes. And then if you feel that you need more clarity, then you can look for CA material, or if you happen to be CA, you look for CMA material or something like that, cross material. But first thing is that we need to be very clear with what is given in our own material, because we will be writing our own exams. Okay. Yeah. So with that being said, we'll start our session. Types of departments, we have dependent department and independent department. And one thing needs to be remembered is that this theory part is nowhere asked in the examination. We don't have to mug up this, but we need to understand this. What he's saying is types of departments, we have dependent types of departments, we have dependent and independent department. So we need to understand this dependent department, which means if I am the group company, I am sitting in Mumbai, I have four departments, A, B, C, D. So each one is one respective department. When I say dependent, this department is depending upon the group company. I mean, like, this main company will decide what A department should do, at what rate they should sell. Should they be selling it to other department? Okay, that what we are calling as transfer price. When you come to CA final, you have in costing subject this chapter, transfer pricing. Okay, so what the intention of this dependent department is that each individual department is depending on the group company's policy. They have to abide by what the main company, group company is talking about. They should, like, what expenditure they should incur. Okay. Should they be selling it to other departments or should they be purchasing from other departments? Okay. They don't have the liberty or freedom of purchasing on their own. They don't have the liberty or freedom of selling on their own, or maybe like deciding the selling price on their own. So they are completely dependent on the group companies. Okay. So it means group policy, company's policy. Okay. In the other way, independent department, which means that this I have A department, B department, C department and D department. Now I'm appointing a person X here. I'm appointing a person X as a manager, here Y as a manager, Z as a manager. So what I will tell them is, it is your own company. I am the group of companies manager. I'm telling that each individual department's manager that boss X, EA is yours. You do whatever you want to do, make sure that you get the highest profits. I will give you a certain percentage as a commission out of your profits. So now he has full freedom of deciding, should he be purchasing it from B, should he not be purchasing it from B, or should he be selling it to C. So it is his own decision will determine what his profit is. Like now X cannot blame Y, X cannot blame B, X cannot blame C, X cannot blame D. Now it's like I'm the group company, like I know, assume that you are X. At the end of the year, I'm calling you to my room, I'm asking you one question. What have you done for the whole year? So now you should tell why your profit is less or why your profit is more, why you should take more remuneration or why you should take less remuneration. Because I have given you the full freedom of deciding your selling price. I have given you the full freedom of the sources of purchase, from where you want to purchase, what kind of production you need to have. So everything I have given it, right? So you are independent of my own decision. Okay, here you are dependent. You can say, sir, I got less profit, not because I am underperformer, but because I had to sell to B at a lesser price. Take an example, in market, one product has been sold for 150. But as a group company, what am I telling X? Hey X, you sell it to B at 120 rupees only. This is called transfer price. You sell it only at 120 rupees. So now at the end of the year, I'm asking you a simple question. Hey X, why your profit is less? You can say one simple reason. I would have earned more profit had you given me more liberty. I had to sell it to B at 120, wherein my own product's market price is 150. I lost 30 rupees just because I had to listen it to you. Okay, now you can put a blame on me. So why this topic is coming here? The only is, are you a dependent department? Are you an independent department? Do you have the freedom to sell to other departments? Or do you have a choice that will be decided by whether you are a dependent department or an independent department? So this is one concept which needs to be clear. So our next topic is advantages of departmental accounts. I'll not be writing on the board because it is not important for examination. It's only just an idea, like what is the need for you to have different departments? Why can't you simply say that the Mumbai branch, what is the company they are having? That is only a single company. Why you need to have a different departments there? Why you need to have the disputes between the managers? You can say that, right? But this concept is telling you what are the advantages, like what benefits you'll get if you have a different departments. Okay, so that is given in the material only. I'll just walk you through evaluation of performance. What do you mean by that? As I just now said, A, B, C, D, there are four departments. And each department is headed by a manager, Mr. X, Mr. Y, Mr. Z or something like that. They are headed by different managers. Now, at the end of the year, you being a CEO or CFO, you can tell them, hey, your performance is really bad, yeah. Your performance is good. Your performance is bad. So, I am able to tell at the company level that which department is doing good, which department is not doing good, and who deserves to be appreciated, who deserves to be rewarded. All that I can decide only if it is a departmentalized. I mean, your activity is only one thing. I will talk about that more in detail. Your activity is only another thing. So I can tell at the end of the year, because you are preparing your own P&L, now I can tell your P&L is looking very bad, your P&L is looking very good. So you are doing better, so I will give you that appreciation or recognition or reward, or I can do something about it. So I can evaluate the performance of each individual departments only when I decide to have the departmental system in my organization. So that is one point. And the second one is growth potential of each department. Okay, so now I can say, see, how much hours amount I'm spending on Mr. This A department, it is not giving any benefits. Listen, for each department, let's assume that initially I spent 10 lakh rupees for each department. This department, see, I'll write it here. For each department, I'm spending 10 lakh rupees as a company's policy. I'm incurring 10 lakh rupees for his furniture, his fixed assets, his manufacturing facility, something like that. So I'm spending 10 lakh for three departments. Right? So now A department is coming up and saying I got 2 lakh profit. This is saying I got 10,000 rupees loss. And he is saying I have 1 lakh rupees as profit. Now as a CEO or CFO, I can tell, Are Baba, how much ever I am spending on you, you are giving me loss only, right? So instead of giving you more capital, I would rather give it to this A so that he performs better for the next quarter or next year. Are you understanding this point? So what we are trying to say is, whom I should push more? Anyway, this person is making losses. Reasons could be many. But now from financial perspective, I can put more effort on this department A and make it a more profitable venture than spending unnecessary money on department B. Okay, so that is the second thing. And justification of capital outlay, this point just now I said, you will understand, for this I spent 10 lakh rupees, what I got? I got only very less profit. So you are saying that, okay, to get this 2 lakh rupees, I spend 10 lakh rupees as my capital. So you are justifying your own decision of, if I spend more on this, you'll get more. So the justification factor will come. And then judgment of efficiency. Now you can say which manager is performing well and which manager is not performing well. You can see their efficiency levels or rather which department is doing better and which department is not doing better. And the last one is planning and control. So in this way, you can plan for the future as to which department needs to be motivated or which needs to be different managers what main changes I can make. So all this you can say when it is a departmental. So this is a theory part for one angle. And methods of departmental accounts. So types are like dependent and independent. This is a methods. Again, remember, our effort should not go in remembering these things. Only you need to understand. Accounts of all departments are kept in one book only. Separate set of books are kept for each department. In simple words, what I can say is, now that main group of companies, what they do is they only prepare the books of accounts like this. See, understand the concept. See, anyway, we will solve the problems. That is the secondary part. First, make your concepts better. This is department A, B, this is C, this is D, and this is A, B, C, D. So in my own ledger, I am preparing separately A, B, C, D. If I'm paying salary to department A, I'll write it here. If I'm making salary to B, I'll write it here. If I'm making salary to C, I'll write it here. If I'm incurring any advertisement expenditure specifically for D, I'll write only in the D's column. So what is this? This is like you are preparing the books of accounts in single books only, but with a different columns. So that is one point. Another is that instead of making this so much of cumbersome, you let A only to prepare his own books of accounts. Jo bhi karna hai, karlo, at the end you give it to me. Okay, so that is only for A. He'll only prepare his own books of accounts. B will prepare his own books of accounts. C will prepare his own books of accounts. At the end, he will give it to the group of companies. Now you consolidate. You consolidate what is the cash balance. You consolidate what is the stock at the end of the year, inventory. Okay, so that needs to be done at the highest level. That is at the group of companies level, group level. Understanding? So these are the two methods of maintaining the books of accounts. And coming to the Next one, basis of allocation of common expenditure among different departments. So this is just a concept builder. Don't expect that we are directly, why we are not directly solving the problem. Reason, if you directly go with the problems, you might get it, but the problem is that you might stuck for the next question. If you know, if an examiner is giving a different question, we might get stuck. So better thing is that we go through the theory part in a detailed manner. Next, come back to this. Basis of allocation of common expenditure among different departments. So here you try to understand for this studio. I'll take an example like this. This is a group of companies. Imagine. This is a company. In this company, here the production will take place. This is one department. Here the processing will take place. This is a second department. Here only research and development will take place. This is another department. Here there is one godown. Here the sales strategies, all those things will take place. So these are the five departments I have in my organization. What will happen? Understand conceptually. It is not that somebody says how do you apportion. You simply giving an answer is not the justification, because in practical world, in reality, post your qualification also, all this what we are learning might not really be applicable in reality. We need to have our own judgmental things. In order to have that judgmental things, we need to understand it contextually. Okay, if something is there, it's not just enough to remember it as it is. It needs to be understood conceptually. How rent rates, see, I have given the basis also in this material, you can see. But our logic is to understand, for this whole company, I might have been paying some rent of 10 lakh rupees. As a group of companies, at the head level, I am paying 10 lakh rupees. Now I have different departments here. Okay, so this rent needs to be allocated to all five departments. It needs to be allocated to all five departments, isn't it? We need to allocate it. So on what basis you can allocate one thing? 10 lakh divided by 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, divided by 5, I can do that. Or I can go with the number of employees. Here there are more number of employees, here less number of employees, here again very less number of employees, here very less number of employees, here go down to only few number of employees. So there could be different in numbers when it comes to employees also. Should I be allocating based upon the number of employees? Should I be allocating based upon the space? Should I be allocating based upon the time? Okay, so now our judgment should come. When you are paying this 10 lakh rupees rent, this is for the entire organization. If you see, most of the place is occupied by the production only. If you want to give like 10 divided by 5, you would say 2 lakh rupees rent. You would come and cry. R&D wala, he'll come and what he'll say? I'm occupying the smallest room in the whole organization, which is just like 1 or 2 rooms, or maybe like just 5 chairs or 10 chairs. Why should I take the bare of 2 lakh rupees? You would simply cry. And here you see, this production wala is occupying lot of space, but again you are putting 2 lakh rupees on his head. I told you, right, each individual department is like, they will look from their point of view only, because they want to increase their own profits, because they want to have more bonus, they want to have more commission for their employees. Here we have a different manager, here we have a different manager, here we have a different, everybody is different, right? So now when you are putting 2 lakh rupees on his head, he will be happy, but this person won't be happy. And this is also not a reasonable allocation, right? The reasonable allocation is, he's occupying less space, so he should be given less allocation. He's occupying more space, he should be given more allocation. Are you understanding this? This is not like a thumb rule, but try to understand the rent, which, see, whatever the expenditure which is based upon the space should go, on the basis of the space only. See, if I'm paying salary, when I'm paying salary, can I pay salary based upon the space? No, right? I pay salary because of the number of employees there. the quality of the employees or the higher grade, lower grade, middle grade. Okay, so not everything can be based upon your space. It is based upon the nature. Okay, each and every point we will discuss here. Hopefully you don't try to mug it up, you try to understand. Yeah. Rent, rates and taxes. So rent is something we are paying based upon the space. Rent and taxes, what do you mean by this rent and taxes? The taxes that you are paying to your government, local government mostly. This is again based upon the space only we will pay. And insurance on building. So when the building expenditure itself is going on the basis of the space, when you're taking an insurance, that insurance should also be going on the basis of the space only. And then lighting, heating expenses, lighting, heating expenses, energy expenses, consumption. Reason I'll tell you. Electricity, lighting, I'm paying 20 lakhs. Now you tell me, who will consume more energy in this department? Who will consume more energy? Will this sales guy will consume any energy or what? He only requires the two sockets for his laptop. That's it. Whoever is working in that department, he only needs that mobile charging or laptop charging, or maybe one to two tube lights, or maybe ACs. That again, that is the central thing. So he requires less of energy. Godown, usme kya hona? Like, what do you need in that godown? Tube lights. No, you not use anything there, or maybe one bigger fan. R&D. Very less processing, maybe some energy, but most of the energy will go to the production only, right? He will be using bigger equipments with bigger voltages. So he would have consumed more energy. So now this 20 lakhs, you cannot say based upon the space. It could so happen that there is only one machine which is occupying this much space, but it is consuming a lot of energy. Okay? Are you understanding this? This lighting or the energy related things cannot be based upon your space. It should be based upon the energy consumed by each department. So this is the same concept you have in your overhead chapter also, costing also. There also you need to apportion. Try to understand here, you will understand there. Try to understand there, you will understand here. Okay. So this is another point. Carriage inwards. What do you mean by this? All I'm trying to say is there is a reason for that, and you try to understand that reason, you don't have to remember. Carriage inwards. What do you mean by carriage inwards? I require certain inputs, certain raw material. This is a supplier. Assuming that there is one central supplier. All departments will purchase from this supplier only, whatever they require. This production ke liye kuch na kuch zarurat hai, they will be purchasing from supplier only. And this product processing also, for them also they require certain raw material. That raw material they'll purchase here. These people also purchase some raw material. Maybe R&D wale uske bhi, for them also they might be requiring some raw material. Sales guys also, very less, but they also require some raw material. Go down, absolutely nil. Okay, but for the sake of understanding, they also require very less of raw material, mostly no, but just for understanding. So now, when you are purchasing this raw material, you need these goods to be transported to your production houses. You need these goods to be transported to your processing house. You need those goods to be coming to your R&D. In simple words, you will pay this carriage inwards. Understand this word inwards, which means you are paying that lorry expenditure, the truck expenditure, while you are purchasing raw material from your supplier. So this should be based upon, not on the space. Maybe they are purchasing more, they are purchasing less, but it should be based upon your purchases. Sorry, they might be having lesser space or higher space. That is not the criteria. The criteria is whoever is purchasing more, they should be taken more hit. In simple words, carriage inwards should be based upon your purchases. Should I be remembering it? No. But try to understand, carriage inwards we pay only when you purchase something. we pay carriage inwards when you are purchasing, right? So if this is purchasing more, you give it more. Okay, if this is purchasing less, you give it less. So the carriage inwards needs to be based upon your purchases. Okay, so why am I stressing so much while solving? You should not like think second time, should it be this or should it be that? Okay, so departmental chapter is very easy if you can understand the concept better. Rather, accounting is easy if you understand all the conceptual things. And then discount received. What do you mean by discount received? I receive the discount. Why? From whom I receive the discount? From the same supplier only, right? So the discount is an income for me. Who should be taking that income? Who is purchasing more? See, anything which is relating to your purchases should be based upon your purchases. Anything relating to your sales should be based upon your sales. Something like this. You have purchases, you have sales, which means each individual department will have their own purchases, each individual department will have their own sales, right? So now anything which is relating to purchases, kya ho sakta? It can be your carriage inwards. Just now we were talking about this carriage inwards. Carriage inwards, or it could be discount received. So all these things should be based upon your purchases. Coming to sales, production department will have some sales. You might ask me a question, sir, how come directly production department will sell? We have a transfer pricing issues at the final level. You'll understand. Sometimes this production department will not have any sales directly. It might not sell it in the open market. Sometimes what will happen is that even this production wala, they complete their processing. They will have one input that they'll send it to this processing. And this will do some processing and they'll give it to the godown. These are all costing concepts, but I'm trying to make it clear that sometimes in some departments, what will happen? The production department will directly give it to the processing, means they will not have any revenue at all. But on for a level battlefield, what they do is they will fix a transfer pricing. Okay, that those things are discussed at the final level. So they will assume as if they are selling it to the open market. Yes, they are selling within the department, within the company only, but they will charge as much as this processing wala, if he is purchasing from open market, what he would have paid, that much money he will charge it to the other departments. So why am I saying this? Production, either they can sell it in the open market or they might give it to the processing wala for a transfer pricing, which will be decided by the company. So these will have some sales. The processing will have some sales. Godown will have some sales. And sales and R&D, they will allocate it. Okay. So very rarely they will be allocating it also. The point of discussion is, when you have a sales, that should be the basis for all your sales related expenditure. What all they can be? Discount allowed. They are giving discount to their customers. They are giving discount to some customers. Here he is giving some discount to customers. He is giving discounts to his customers. I'm assuming that everybody is involved in the sales. So now all this discount allowed expenditure should be based upon their respective sales. And sometimes there will be bad debts. Bad debts also are based upon your sales. If you make more sales, the chances that you will have more bad debts. So the one who is making more sales should take maximum hit. So that is the basis of understanding. Okay, I'm not saying these are all the things that you'll have now. You might have a new thing in examination or in practical thing. Understand the logic of it. Is it related to sales? Is it related to purchases? Is it related to the place occupied? Or is it related to the number of employees? Or is it only a time based? Sometime depreciation, company, what they say is, I want to charge depreciation at the rate of 10% of value. Jo bhi value hai, uske upar 10% lagna chahiye. So that is a company's decision. So what you can say, the depreciation you will give based upon the assets each department is holding. If this department is holding more assets, you give that more depreciation to it. If this is holding less assets, obviously the sales department will not have any assets, mostly very less. So you will give less depreciation to sales. So try to understand this. The depreciation should be based upon the value of each assets. Sometimes in institute questions or maybe in any other question, they will not be giving the value of the machine in each department. They will not be giving the value of machine in each department. They will not be giving the value of machine in each department. What you can do is, you can give on the basis of the time, or you can give on the basis of the number of departments. This is your discretion. Whenever you are making that assumption, you have to make it clearly in your examination. Like, it is assumed that the depreciation has been charged based upon the time or based upon the number of departments. That is absolutely up to you. But if they have given the value of the machines in each departments, now you cannot make that decision. You cannot make that assumption. Assumption you can make only when there is ambiguity in the question, only when there is absence of information in the question. When the information is clearly evident, he is giving the value of the machine in each department, which implies that that indirectly is asking you to calculate the depreciation based upon the value of machine in each department. Now you cannot say that the depreciation has been apportioned based upon the time or number of departments. Okay, that will be rubbish. Fine. So like that, there are many things. I'm not reading all those things. As I said, we will be solving the problem. Yes. There is one more concept that needs to be understood, which is stock reserve. This I'll explain and we'll go to the numbers. What do you mean by the stock reserve and why we need to prepare it, understand it conceptually? As we are talking about, there were four departments, A, B, C, as well as D. So in these departments, what they have done is, they have a stock whose cost is 100 for department A. For them to produce this unit, they incurred 100 rupees, or maybe they might have purchased from outside market. Either case, their cost is coming up to 100. For department A, there is one article, or then there is one unit of product whose cost is 100 rupees. Okay, either they purchased it from open market or they manufactured internally, we don't know, but their cost is 100 rupees. So what they have done is, as a group policy, they have given it to B for 120. So this is what we are calling as transfer pricing. We have a larger concept of this in our final, but for time being, understand, for a department whose cost is 100, they are giving it to another department for internal transfer at 120. Okay, so now what will happen in their P&L? In their P&L, develop the concept. When they are purchasing in the open market, they might have paid 100 rupees. So what they would show? Purchases 100 on the debit side. Don't focus on the presentation, understand the concept. When they are purchasing in the open market, they would have debited 100. Now when they are selling it to the other department at 120, they would show it as 120 on the credit side by sales or internal transfer, which means, assuming that there is no opening stock, there is no closing stock, there is no other expenditure, just for one concept builder, I'm just giving you this example. They have a debit of 100, credit of 120, which means that they have a profit of 20. So this A will come and say, yes, I got a profit of 20. But in reality, coming to B, what is the possibilities for B? He could have sold outside market, or it could have been with him as a closing stock. Understand the logic. Department B, they got it from A at 120. So when they are preparing their P&L, what they would say, as a B, thinking I'm as a B, I purchased this article from A at 120. So I would say 120 is my purchase. I'm assuming that all the fundamentals are good with you. So hoping if that is the case, you'll understand this. So their purchase is 120. Had they sold in the open market for 150, they would have showed this 150 as a sales, and they would have showed 30 rupees as their gross profit. Right? Now, I am the CFO of the group of companies. Nice to assume like that. So what they will think? Department A got a profit of 20. I'll write it here. Department A got a profit of 20. Department B got a profit of 30. Total, it is a 50 rupees profit for me as a company, not as a department. As a department, A has got a profit of 20. B got a profit of 30. Total, it is 50. He's like a father. These two are like sons. Each son has got 20 rupees. He has got 20 rupees profit. He has got 30 rupees as a profit. For the company, as a father, what he would say is, yes, my two sons got nice profits. My profit is 50. So now you can say, is it really true? Yes, it's true. Because A got the product in the open market for 100. B sold in the open market for 150. 150 minus 100 is giving me 50. But for just to test their capacity, just to test their efficiency, I made it departmental wise. Now he got 20, he has got 30 as a profit. Sir, I understand this. Why are you saying this again? Again, reason is that if it so happens that department B has not sold in the open market, he couldn't make a sale in the open market, it is still lying with him as a closing stock. Understand? A got it for 100, gave it to B for 120. So it's a 20 rupees profit for A, one brother. Now B, he couldn't make it in the open market. He couldn't make any sale in the open market. So he would continue to show it as a closing stock. At what price he will show? He will show it at cost only. Sir, you can say, sir, what is the cost? Sir, cost is only 100. No, cost is not 100. I'm saying he's a different department. For him, the cost is the amount that he spent. B has spent 120 rupees to get it from A, right? Understand? If you are a B, what is your cost? How much you are paying to A? Don't think what is the cost for the A. You think from your side. Now you are a dependent, independent department. What is your cost? You committed to pay 120 rupees, right? So that is your cost. You couldn't make a sale, which means that is lying in your closing stock. When you are lying in the closing stock, our AS2 also what it says, it should be at cost. What is your cost? Your cost is 120. You show it at 120. Opening stock 120, closing stock 120, there is no profit. Now, you are one brother, another brother is there. He is going to the father and saying, father, I got 20 rupees as the profit. So happy. B is saying, no, I couldn't make any profit. Zero. But from father's perspective, what he would say, I got 20 rupees profit. Is it so? No. If you see the larger picture now, it was like departmental is like a smaller picture. Larger picture is A got it for 100. He sold it to B. He's keeping it himself. Which means that in a company like this, somebody purchased it and he's selling it to another department. He's keeping the closing stock. Where is the profit? Profit will come only when you make a sale in the open market. So when this is lying in your closing stock, it is not a profit. Yes, on a departmental level, it is a profit for you. But as a company level, there is no profit. This 20 needs to be eliminated. That is called stock reserve. I hope it is understood. So I have taken a lot of time in explaining this. The only reason is that the same concept we will apply in the other main questions. There we need not be giving this much of explanation. And one more thing, you have consolidation financial statements like... when you're going for the second group of accounts, so you will have this. there this concept will come. So there we should not scratch our head. It should be clear here itself. Okay, if a concept is dedicated for departmental account, you be clear with that, but the same concept you will use it in some other chapter. Yes. So, sir, what is this, sir? What we will do? In AS books of accounts, there is a profit which is not realized. So, that we are calling as unrealized gain. Unrealized gain is 20 rupees, which we need to eliminate. In mathematically, we are simply saying deduct it. But we are accountant, right? We are accountant. There should be an entry for that. The entry is that, when you are preparing your P&L, how did you write? You wrote 100 rupees as your purchase, 120 as your sales, okay? And you are saying your gross profit is 20, assuming that there is no other transaction, and your gross profit carried down is 20. So now what we should do? We should eliminate this 20. We should make it zero. How we can make it zero? You simply debit your here stock reserve 20. So what is the net effect? No profit, no profit. Okay? This we need to convert it as a journal entry. How we can convert from this side? You call it as a P&L, as everybody knows. So P&L account debit 20 to, you can write stock account directly or inventory account, but that is wrong. Reason, maybe for the current year this is unsold for B, maybe next year you might be selling it, right? So instead of dealing directly with the stock, what we do is we'll prepare a stock reserve account. Okay, stock reserve account, P&L account data to stock reserve for the current year. Next year I will reverse this, stock reserve account debit to P&L, which means maybe for the current period B has not sold, maybe in the next year he might sell it, right? So I will reverse this entry for the next year. So this is useful for the other illustrations. So this is projection of the current year, like general entry for the current year. This is a general entry for the next year. And in balance sheet, how do you show this? The balance sheet is very simple. In B's books of accounts, the stock was showing at 120, right? The stock reserve is 20 rupees. So 20 you deduct it from the stock and you show it at 100. In simple terms, AS2 is very clearly saying that your cost should be at your inventory should be valued at your cost or NRV, whichever is lower. So we are valuing it at cost. So we are following the accounting standard also. Yeah. So there are two departments, department P and department Q. And what they are doing is P normally will transfer goods to Q at 50% above cost. 50% above cost. If the closing stock of department Q is 27,000, iske paas abhi closing stock is valued at 27,000. Now we need to understand what is the stock reserve which needs to be eliminated, or what is the value at which the stock needs to be shown in your balance sheet. We always use this logic called cost plus profit equal to sales. If I'm an entity, I'll have some cost, I'll add some profit, and I'll make a sale. Very simple logic, right? So if the question is saying 50% above cost, the cost has to be 100. Why 100, sir? Because above cost means he's talking, is referring something as a cost, right? So whatever he's referring, that should be 100. Okay, so cost has to be 100 plus he's saying 50% is a profit margin. So 50 is a profit equal to 150. Books, it is showing 27,000. Is it 100 or is this 150? You need to understand this. This is a Q's books of accounts, right? So he would have included profit also in it, obviously. So this is 150. And what is he asking? He is asking the stock reserve. He is asking this portion. So this is what? How you can do? If you are a mathematics student, you can do it better. 27,000 multiplied by 50 equal to 150 into x. Just an assumption. So what you can do in the next step, 27,000 into 50, this will come down 150. I'm not here to tell you mathematics. I'm also not very good with that. But in examination, if you just mess up somewhere, you draw the chart like this, you make your own formula, your own, whatever they say, step, you can write it. And absolutely, you will not go wrong. And if you have to write the wordings also, how you can write, what is this 27,000? 27,000 is a closing stock. Closing stock. And what is this 50? 50 is a profit. Profit margin. And what is this 150? 150 is the transfer price. That's only right. This is the transfer. See here sales, which means transfer price. Transfer price. Okay. So if you happen to forget this also, you can make it from here. Yeah. So this 27,000 is the, so yeah, 27,000 is the closing stock, which means what is the stock reserve? 9,000. 1 by 300. Yeah. So 9,000 will be your stock reserve. We'll go to the next question. Illustration 2. Illustration 2. Z Limited has three departments and submits the following information for the year ending. They have three departments. A, B, C. And they have given units. They have made purchases. I'll write it here for the sake of everybody if somebody is not having this question. Purchase in units. I'll write it once for all. Yes, the question is, there are three departments A, B, C. They have purchased these many number of units, and the amount is 6 lakhs. Each individual department has made some sales. They are given in units and they are given the selling price. So if you multiply these two, you will get the sales price also. And they have given the closing stock. Now the point to be catched here is, he has given the purchased units, sales units, closing stock units, but he has not given the opening stock units. By the look at the question only, you can understand. He gave the purchase units, sales units, closing stock units. So this opening units he has not given, which we can prepare from a working note. Means while reading the question, you should able to understand. Aray, ye question mein mereko, I need to prepare this working note also. I need to prepare the working note for the opening stock, opening units. Okay. And one more thing, when you are preparing the opening units also, cost price he has not given. He has not given. So you can say, when the cost price is not given, I'll take it from the purchases. But even in purchase also, you observe three departments are purchasing three different units and they are paying 6 lakh rupees directly. But we don't know what is the purchase price for each separate unit. Okay, so this is also hidden. So there are two informations which are hidden in the question. We can make one assumption to resolve this issue. How? Just focus on the board. You are preparing trading account. Thank you. See, one point I want to reiterate is, answer is there in your book. I'm not telling the answer which you're solving is something great. But the way in which we need to interpret the question, the way we need to understand the answer, that is more important. Getting the number from the exam, no, from the book is not the preparation for us. Yes, you feel that you are making the preparation, but in examination you would struck somewhere. But if you really understand what was given in the question, why the institute has solved the question in that way only, what was the real logic behind this, if you can understand that real logic, you will be really confident to go in the examination and write and get maximum marks. I mean, like exemption to pakka, like remaining leave it to other things, but exemption is, you know, minimum thing that you can expect from the accounts subject. Yeah. So coming to our point, as we are coming to departmental accounts, I'm sure you are good with your other trading activities also. We'll write here two purchases. Whatever you make purchases, you can write it here. You will write two opening stock, two purchases. Buy sales, buy closing stock. So this much to pakka we know. Here trading account will have opening stock, purchases, sales, closing stock. What I would do as a student, I would always look for the easiest way of writing the answer. Easiest is, in all this question, what was the easiest thing for you? He has given the sales units, sales amount. Can't I simply multiply these two and get my sales here? Like 6120 multiplied by 40, 11520 multiplied by 45, 14976 multiplied by 50. Understanding this logic, it's like a puzzle. You need to start somewhere, but you start with the puzzle . So you will be like, I'm sure this is right. I don't know what about the other things. I'm sure this is right. So you start with that. Okay. So calculation I would not do. I have done in my separate book because it takes time to write all those things. I'll write it here directly. Getting all the sales, we have units, we have selling price, we multiplied, we got it. Now what all we required? We required purchases also. Okay, so we required purchases also. In the question, he has given the purchase amount is 6 lakhs, but he has not given what should I be writing in for each different departments. That he has not given, right? So what we will do is, we will take one assumption, that assumption understand properly. The assumption is that we have a selling price, right? We have a selling price. From this selling price, I will try to find out my cost price. Put it simply, I have a selling price which is given in the question, 40, 45, 50. From that, I will find out what is the gross profit for the entire company. As a percentage, I'll find out. Then I'll find out what is my cost price. Once I find the cost price for each individual unit, I can multiply that cost price with the amount of units that I purchased. Understand the logic. Calculation is not I'm trying to say. What I'm trying to say is, we don't have any other way. We need to find one cost price. How we can find the cost price? He has given the selling price. Selling price is given. From this selling price, we need to go back to the cost price. This logic I just now I told you, right? Cost plus profit equal to sales. So in the question, he has given the sales price, like 40, 45, 50. We don't know cost price. So the easiest way is to find out the profit margin. From selling price, you deduct the profit margin, you would get the cost price. All I'm trying to say is, this is the base for your costing subject also. getting an answer is not the end. Don't feel so happy by getting an answer, because in examination we should get that thought, right? So while in your preparation, you focus on your thought process. वो आंसर स्टार्ट करने से पहले ना, इवन बिफोर स्टार्टिंग योर आंसर यू हैव टू एनालाइज ये पूरा क्वेश्चन में आई हैव द सेलिंग प्राइस इफ आई नो द कॉस्ट प्राइस बिकॉज ओपनिंग स्टॉक आई कैन फाइंड इट फ्रॉम द वर्किंग नोट्स सी आई कैन हैव ओपनिंग स्टॉक इन यूनिट्स परचेजेस इन यूनिट्स क्लोजिंग स्टॉक इन यूनिट्स मीन्स आई हैव एवरीथिंग इन यूनिट्स हियर ऑल्सो एवरीथिंग इन यूनिट्स हियर ऑल्सो एवरीथिंग इन यूनिट्स ऑल आई एम मिसिंग राइट नाउ इज the cost price. The cost price is not given in the question, that we are trying to arrive by the selling price. I'm repeating this point many times. The only reason is that calculation aram se ho jata, you can do it very quickly provided you get that logic of it. The logic is selling price de diya, from the selling price you deduct the profit margin, you get the cost price, you multiply with the opening stock, you'll get, you multiply with the purchases, you get, you multiply with the closing stock, you get, at the end you get the gross profit also. It's not an issue. If it comes for 5 months, you can do it in 10 minutes, but you should not stuck with the logic that I should get my cost price from the sales. Sir, you talk so much, but tell me how you get it. I'm rubbing the question because I need some space to write. Yeah. So what I just now said, cost plus profit equal to sales, or cost equal to sales minus profit. This much we know it, right? So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to find the sales price. What is my sales price? I cannot find for each individual department. Why can't you find, sir? Because the purchases, whatever is given in the question, is not for the individual department, it is for the company as a whole, right? So the selling price should also be company as a whole. So that is, we are getting it as I'll write it here. Maybe this is 1 point. How many units you purchased? We just lost that, right? We made purchases of 6,000, 12,000, 14,000. Yeah. So I'll repeat my point. We didn't lose anywhere. It's just that I lost the numbers. So what I'm trying to do, we purchased these many units, right? So in this question, the examiner or the institute is making an assumption. The assumption is that had you sold all your purchases at the existing sales price. In your existing sales, we have a selling price, we have a selling price, we have a selling price, right? So what this assumption is, had you sold all your purchases at the existing selling price, what would have been your gross profit? I'll repeat this point. You purchased these many units A, B, C. If you sell all the units at this price, in fact, we are not making these many. See, X, we are not selling 6,000 units. We are selling 6,120. But the assumption is that if you apply the sales selling price to your purchases, you see, why, sir, somebody might ask, sir, why you are taking purchases only as a sales? In fact, we sold different number of units. The reason is that we have a purchase price only as a collection of all the units, right? So we assume that we sold only those many units, only for the assumption. The assumption is valid because we have a purchase price, right? So purchases A, B, C, we assume we sold it at the existing selling price 45, 50. So we are getting this as 15 lakh. Yeah, 15 lakh. You can do that calculation later. This is the selling price. Sir, what are you trying to say? This is the selling price of your purchases. This is the selling price or sales value of your all purchases minus your purchases. What is your purchases? You purchased it for 6 lakhs. Open your question and see it. You purchased it for 6 lakhs, right? So 6 lakhs is your purchases, which means 9 lakhs is your profit, GP. So what is the GP ratio? 9 lakhs divided by 15 lakhs into 100, you will get 60%. In nutshell, what I can say is, if you apply the same selling price to your existing purchases, you see the scenario. The scenario is that you are making 60% as a profit on your sales. So from 60%, what I can get? Can I get the cost price? Sales price is 40, sales price is 45, sales price is 50 for different three individual departments, right? Usme se if I remove that 60%, why are you removing this 40 is the sales price. From sales price, I'm removing the GP. So if I'm removing the GP 60%, I would be getting my cost price only, right? Understanding the logic, the cost price that we are getting is 16, 18, 20. So what are these? These are the cost prices. So this cost price, I can use it for the purchases. Well, how many units I purchased? Just now we did the calculation. Our purchases was 6,000 into 16. I'll do it for 96,000. And the B, how many units we purchased? 12,000 into 18. See, don't focus on the calculation. Our logic is not the calculation. Our intention of making the video is also not the calculation. And the third one, we purchased 14,400 units. Each unit we are purchasing it for 20. 2,88,000. Understanding what we have got so far, don't miss the line. The line is that we believed that we sold all the goods that we purchased. We find out the gross profit. From the gross profit, from the sales price, we removed the gross profit. We got the cost. The cost into number of units. So A aa gaya. We got it. Now for the closing stock, in the question, had he given the closing stock? Yes, he has given. The closing stock is 600, 960 and 36. What I can do? Our AS2 is also saying the same thing. Closing stock should be valued at cost. Our cost is given here, 16 into 600, 9,600. Like that, you can write it here. The same way, opening stock we don't know, but we know the cost price. Sir, can you find out it? You have two ways. Easiest way is gross profit, that we know it, right? See, isme of 2,44,800, 60% is our gross profit. So 146,880. Understanding, easiest way is, in the old question, what you found out is gross profit is 60%. So sales mein 60% is your gross profit. This mein 60% is your gross profit. I'll do for this also. 518, 400 into 60%. Yes. Here also you'll get it. So when you have sales, when you have closing stock, when you have gross profit, you have purchases, this can be your balancing figure, the easiest way. But other way of saying is this. This is one way, you got the answer. Like, you add these two, you deduct these two, you'll get this. I'm not telling that because at this level, it is expected that you know this. You add these two, you deduct these two, you'll get this. Okay, so that is your balancing figure. Other way of saying, sir, in examination, if he's asking what is the opening stock in units, how can we find out? Again, this is not a formula. You understand the logic like this. You understand the logic. You have a godown here. This is your godown. You have some stock. Assuming this is your stock, which you are calling as an opening stock. During the period, you might purchase some more items. That is your purchases. Means as and when you purchase, the stock will again go up. It will increase. When you make a sale, how do you make a sale? From this only you will give it to somebody else. Sales. So whatever is left over is your closing stock. Pictorially, you try to understand. I'm not drawing it nicely. But you have a opening stock at the beginning of the year. When you purchase, the stock will go up. When you purchase, it will go up. When you make it, it will go down, right? So whatever is left is your closing stock. So how can you use that in your formula? Opening stock plus purchases minus closing stock equal to your sales. In this question, build your concept. Opening stock is not given. You treat it as X or let it be opening stock only. Purchases, you know in number. That number, jo bhi number, you write it there. Closing stock, you have given in number. You have sales also in number, 6120. Okay? Can't you find out like this? So everything, you take it out that side, you will get it. Okay? So I tried to develop that concept. I didn't tell you how to write it. Maybe for one thing I'll write. Maybe you feel that we have not covered that aspect. Opening stock, we don't know, right? So let it be X. Purchases, how many units we purchased? 6,000 units we purchased. 6,000 minus closing stock given in the question, 600. Sales, 6120. So X equal to 6120 minus 6,000. So that will become 120. 120 plus 600, 720. So that will be your opening stock. Is it right? Yes. 720 is opening stock. But don't write 720 here. 720 is the number of units. 720 into or multiplied by your cost. What was your cost? 16. 720 into 16. You'll get 11,520. You apply the same logic here. So my intention is that not that I solve every problem and you will be there. You will be listening. It's like we solve few questions. We try to understand. And one more thing. It's not me who will be solving the problem. It's you. You will be solving the problem. But I'll only help or facilitate in solving those questions. Okay. So you solve this entire question on your own. And this is illustration 2. And we have illustration 3 also. That is also exactly the same question. You try to solve on your own without seeing the answer. And then at the end, you see the answer. Then you feel that confidence. Okay. So like that, you can build your concepts. And if you get your answer, illustration 3 also, let me know through comment session. I'll be happy to know that. Thanks for watching. Have a nice day.